We welcome everyone to today's Impact Speaker Series, Mentoring Session 4 on Challenges in Supply Chain and Measures for Business Sustainability. The series is aimed to focus on various important aspects like market trends, challenges, and changing scenarios. We are confident that insights and learning shared by the mentors and the leaders will be beneficial for MSMEs, established and emerging ventures. There are a few house rules for the day. Please keep your mics on off mode and please share your questions in the chat box. And there's one more humble request to all the participants who have joined. Please rename yourself with your name because of the Zoom, there are a lot of things had happening. So with that, we are delighted to welcome and introduce our eminent panelist for the day, S. Ramakrishna, Managing Director, Balaji Maryline, and immediate past chairman, Federation of Freight Forwarders Association of India. Andy Tuggle, Senior Vice President, Delaplex Enterprise Supply Chain Export. Mr. Pinak Kulkarni, Founder, Spark, and Supply Chain Consultant. We are pleased to welcome our moderators for the day. Bhavin Bhagat, Founder, India-based for sale, Joint Honorable Secretary at TIE Ahmedabad. Devika Ramesh, Executive Director, RMP Group of Companies and Treasurer at TIE Coimbatore. Dr. Rashmi Bansal, Founder, DCC Consultant and TIE Women, TIE Nagpur Core Team Member and Associate Member at TIE Nagpur. We have with us Smita Siddhanti. She's the Global Board Member at TIE Global. And we have our Presidents from TIE Ahmedabad, Saurabh Mehta, TIE Nagpur, Mr. Nitin Sajdeva, and from TIE Coimbatore, Ms. Ranjana Singhal. So with that, now I invite Swati, she's the ED at TIE Coimbatore chapter, to please take over the session from here. So over to you, Swati.
Thank you, Ms. Nidhi. Before we start, I would like to welcome Mr. Pinak Kulkarni to share his thoughts on the domestic perspective of supply chain in India. Mr. Pinak, over to you.
Thanks. I need the host to pass over the share screen in screen share to me because I need to make a 3-slide presentation. By the time the host passes on the rights to me, let me take you through my introduction, which may take 30 seconds so that I can then proceed with my presentation. Someone said I'm an expert in this field. I'm not. I'm just a student of this subject for the last 2 decades. Just love the topic. I have evolved from being an industry professional to being a consultant in the domain. Have been running Spark for the last 11 years. I do 3 major things: consulting, training, and I do coaching for senior leadership in the domain of supply chain. I'll keep my introduction brief to this point. Unfortunately, I don't see that the host has passed on the screen sharing to me.
Sir, you should be able to share this.
Yes, now it is. Thank you so much. I've done my introduction. I don't want to elaborate too much on that. You could always Google who I am and what I do in my life to keep myself running. I would like to spend the next 3 to 5 minutes talking about where does supply chain in India stand for? I personally believe that we are at a strategic inflection point. I've just borrowed this term from, only the paranoid survive. Fundamentally, we as supply chains in India are at a strategic inflection point. It's the life in the business of any entity where a dramatic change in its existence is likely to happen. If you do the right things, you grow on the trajectory of growth. If you don't do the right things, you extinguish. I fundamentally believe that we are at that stage of supply chain in India. I may have my own reasons which I could elaborate upon, but to keep my talk within the limit of 3 to 5 minutes, I'll not get into the details of why I believe it is so. But fundamentally, that's my take on supply chain in India. We'll have to create an ecosystem of a sustainable supply chain. And what does it mean to create a sustainable supply chain if I'm an MSME, if I'm an entrepreneur who has ventured onto a journey of running an enterprise in any domain of industry. I think we as a indigenous supply chain need to dwell upon how do I create a sustainable supply chain, which means I don't want to create a supply chain which is a single dimension supply chain trying to exploit a single variable of the competitiveness which makes my supply chain be competitive vis-a-vis an other country supply chain. I think there are this, I call it as a 5P framework. And I think we'll have to evolve on these 5Ps: people, process, performance, policies, and paradigms. I'll take 30 seconds to explain this. People, in my opinion, will be the core to the supply chain. We need to develop what is called as a people-focused supply chain. There's an internal culture of an organization and external market demand. And there has to be a synchronization between the internal culture of an organization which goes and meets an external market. And people-focused supply chains will need to be developed. Mechanisms to deliver an result, which in my opinion is creating stakeholder value, has to have processes. These are mechanisms to achieve the goals. People perform the way they are measured. And particularly if you look at the Indian context of working, I'm very sure that we all appreciate that. It's all about how do you get measured. I mean, if you are a firefighter and your company starts appraising firefighters with higher increments, you need fire to get yourself appraised better. So we need to have the right performance metrics. Cannot borrow the standard matrices which have been running for the last 30 years in the domain of supply chain. Going forward, sustainability will be a function of policy making. And policy making actually creates the framework within which the supply chain operates. And the last one, which is extremely dear to me in my own consulting world, I keep talking about it all the time, is the paradigm that matters. I mean, I logged into the session at 16 past five, and I've been hearing a lot of talk around COVID and how it has got actually built up. Isn't it the paradigm? It's the fundamental belief of people. 15th February, 20,000 cases. Yesterday, 386,000 cases. A demand increase of 19 times. The demand side grew 19 times. And how do you handle that? If you have the right paradigm, you'll be able to handle that. And that's exceedingly important in the 21st century supply chain. It is neither going to be a static supply chain nor a dynamic supply chain. It's going to be a chaotic supply chain. So paradigms will matter the most. These five P's will create a sustainable supply chain to overcome the challenges of the supply chain. This is the last slide that I wanted to share before I hand it over back to Swati. I think this phase of life that all of us are passing through in the 21st century, irrespective of if COVID would have happened or wouldn't have happened, that wouldn't have made much of a difference to it. The fundamental thing that we need to realize is there has been a lot of talk on creating resilient supply chain. Resilience is a phenomenon where you bounce back from a disruption to reach a status that you actually had. I think we'll have to exploit the opportunity in the Indian supply chains to create what is called as an anti-fragile supply chain. And I think, I always say this, it is the Japanese moment for Indian supply chain. What Japan did to the world in the 1960s and 70s, which after 50 years of it, we still keep following as the world-class manufacturing practice. I think India has this as an opportunity, which I call it as the Japanese moment in the Indian supply chain. It's there on my blog for anyone to read it further. Leveraging on the indigenous supply chain practices. The indigenous supply chain practices have evolved very nicely over a period of time. And as we grow the supply chain henceforth in the world, indigenous practices will actually create an anti-fragile supply chain. It can be the production-linked incentive scheme which the government declared, all the way up to various initiatives that people have been taking on the ground. And that can actually be leveraged by any organization to create an anti-fragile. Anti-fragile is a very important term, by the way. I mean, it's a term which is which talks about not only avoiding a negative impact, it actually talks about creating more positive out of a challenging situation. And I think this is the right time for Indian supply chains to look at it. And I'm very sure with a $5 trillion economy knocking the door in a few years' time, if you create an indigenous supply chain, we should be, you know, doing a great job. Just going back to Swati on this, because I think I've said what I wanted to say in the 5 minutes that will be.
Thank you, Mr. Kulkarni. That was indeed a lot of information in a brief 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Now I'd like to call upon Mr. S. Ramakrishna to please give us a brief about the various forces in play in supply chain in regard to India and a cross-border movement.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Yes, I am. I have been in the field of international freight fraud avoiding and the custom broking for almost 4 decades. Cross-border movement. But every time there is a cross-border movement, problem is there. And our resilience actually comes in the forefront and we come out of that. I will not say, as Pinakas put it, that it is not that, you know, it is every time we bounce back and do everything absolutely what is needed. But at the same time, the government agencies who have really pitched in for efficient movement of the cross-border has been a fantastic effort. The efforts taken by the government in terms of ease of doing business, I am not getting into the arena of the numbers, what the World Bank are talking about, but I can tell you for sure that the government, what they are going to, what they are doing and what they are going to do in further on the ease of doing business is, as you all know, that we have been onto the electronic mode of doing transacting business from the private sector to the government sector. Actually, it has really brought in the focus of how easy it is doing the business in India. In all real terms, the custom clearing, what we are focusing, I focus on the businesses, is not a very, I should say, not a very easy business in terms of in the world that Indian customs are very tough and very difficult. But today, the Indian customs have brought into the electronic mode in such a way that you can really preempt and do the business in a very easy manner. Preempt in the sense that you actually know what are the documents required, what are the processes involved in all those things, of kinds of things which have been done, and it has become very easy. It is not only from Indian perspective, it is from an international perspective. Having said this, there are various players into this in the logistics sector of the international border. It is not only the custom brokers or the freight forwarders, the shipping lines or airlines. There are various participating agencies apart from the customs, what they are doing. So the government of India, the Ministry of Finance has taken a stand that each of the players have need to be together in one portal, which is called as an ICE gate. I'm sure many of the participants will know about the ICE gate. And in the ICE gate, there are various participating agencies like a drug controller or other agencies like plant and quarantine, food safety standard people, all have been interlinked to each other. And they have also created a matrix by which each of the HSN, which is a harmonized code, which is also internationally known as a BTN, are linked to each other. And it actually, if we put in those data into the system, we really know what are the documents required, what are the formalities required, what is the prerequisite documents which need to be submitted to the customs, etc. Now at this pandemic stage, prior to beginning of this meeting, we were just talking about, Smita talking about the COVID and everything. I must tell you, any COVID material coming into India at whether the international airport or at the seaport are cleared within half an hour's time. just half an hour's time, not much of a formality. The national calamity is taken into consideration. Various things have been the formalities have been reduced and everything is on electronic mode. Now, for example, the Indian Air Force are making sorties in various places like Dubai, Singapore, Dammam, and bringing in the oxygen concentrators and oxygen tankers. And it is also coming to an Indian Air Force base where their customs people are not there at all. But the nearby the custom officers are deputed and it is cleared. The purpose of my saying this is that the logistic per se for the international cross-border, as far as current situation is concerned, is extremely conducive and it is very easy for us to do the business in this unfortunate situation. And if you really see about the vaccine and other medicine movement within India, the almost all the air carriers of India have really pitched in and they announced their schedules way ahead and they say these are the facilities available and they move the cargo in such a speedy manner is really appreciable. I think on the other international arena of our the supply chain movement, especially in the cross-border. Earlier, we used to have only the air and sea. Now, it is apart from the air and sea, there is a road movement, of course, was there. There is also inland waterways, especially from Ganges and Brahmaputra. We do a lot of business with Bangladesh, Nepal on inland waterways. I think if these also are really utilized well for the total inland waterways which is available in India, it is going to be a much bigger game change. As far as the paradigm shift is concerned, every day there is a paradigm shift and every movement, what is happening in the international arena is really appreciable. I will stop here, then anything else we can discuss later. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ramakrishnan. That was a very brief and crisp introduction. I would now like to call upon Mr. Andy to share the international law of supply chain across the world. Over to you, Mr. Andy.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it. I would like to take this time to, again, thank everyone here on the board. I know across the world, we are all going through a lot of change, a lot of difficult times. So I wanted to start off with just giving everyone the best and hoping that we will all be able to pull through this together. In that same token, with here in the United States, we have gone through a lot of challenges over the last year and a half. And through that, we've seen a sea change in the way a lot of these clients that we work with on our tier one level have changed the way they've thought about their organization. Supply chain has become a mainstream topic, whereas before it was usually just discussed in corporate rooms and certain silos of organizations were kind of talking about how to improve supply chain. But during the COVID, we've been able to see a lot of gaps that were highlighted. And truly what it came down to as well was the employees themselves. We've seen a lot more of a focus on employees' well-being, making sure that that they are understanding that the corporate level that they are thinking about how to improve their day-to-day operations. And so with that, when gaps are being able to be analyzed, which a lot of the team members that I have, both in the functional and technical, have gone in to work with supply chain leaders to identify gaps in their workflow, what is causing them to miss the forecasts and have an extensive cost associated with failing to meet these forecasts accurately. And so in doing so, they've taken a collaborative effort to embrace, instead of organizations being in silos, they brought people together, whether it be in IT or finance or whatever division, brought them into these pods and had them working together to understand what is necessary to be to adapt, to be resilient and be able to come out stronger. And for that, especially here, in the States, we've seen a lot of innovation, whether it be through new mobile applications that are allowing team members to communicate clearly. We've seen a lot of remote working, but through that, communication has been key. In identifying gaps in team members, I have a great team of developers behind me that help work with our clients to fill those gaps and make these workflows stronger. But you know, the main key is being able to have the adaptation and the embracing of this technology by employees. And a lot of what you are finding now is with that, applying these new technologies is really working with your employees so that there's a comfort level and understanding so that they can embrace it and therefore communicate better and grow stronger together. And you can see that that is actually taking place. And therefore, whether it's through warehouses, distribution centers, grocery store chains, convenience stores, all of these folks are working together to make life as normal as possible. And what we see is that, you know, again, with the embrace of technology, that we are actually becoming stronger. And I think as a whole, working together to bring people together and understanding how we can actually come out of this stronger. So I thank you for the opportunity, and we can dive more into this later in the conversation.
Thank you, Mr. Adi. I would now request Mr. Sharma to please take over the discussion forward with Mr. Pinak. Over to you, ma'am.
Mr. Pinak Kulkarni, on behalf of everyone here today, thank you for taking time to speak to us on a very interesting topic, challenges in supply chain on domestic perspective. Your comments were well received by the audience. We have some questions for you, sir. What should be the approach of an entrepreneur to build his enterprise, the supply chain?
Okay. I'll leverage on my experience of having helped companies to build their own supply chain. And if you're an entrepreneur who gets into this, it starts with appreciating that any entrepreneur is there to create value for his stakeholders. And at an startup stage or at an initial stage of business, clarity about who the stakeholders are is exceedingly important. So the first approach is to safeguard that. Second most important thing is the mechanism by which I'll develop my supply chain is I need to improve my revenues, and my revenues get improved if I have a volume-based growth or I have a new product introduction-based growth. So as an entrepreneur, you have to plan out that way. Second most important focus is how do I expand my operating margins? And the approach to expanding your operating margins is predominantly focused on optimizing your cost of goods sold and trying to optimize your general and administrative expenses. But the most crucial part, in my opinion today, is how do I improve my asset efficiency? And the two assets which I think are extremely crucial, one is typically the plant, equipment, machinery, and improving the productivity of those. But the most crucial asset, which I think an entrepreneur needs to keep in mind today, is the cash-to-cash cycle. So if I'm an entrepreneur, I need an approach, then this is the approach that I would probably take. A, create stakeholder value, enable the stakeholder value through revenue growth opportunities, operating margin expansion initiatives, most importantly, utilize the assets. And to help that, you have one level below, which is volume-based or product introduction-based growth, et cetera, which I explained. And I'm lucky that I've been able to shape up a few entrepreneurs in my own working, where I've really realized that, that it really works.
Can I ask you, what are the competitive levers of supply chain?
Okay. Typically speaking, there are four levers of supply chain which can create a competitive advantage. I'll spell them out first. One is time, second is cost, third is quality, and fourth is service. And they all are undergoing a dramatic change. Now, just a simple example for all of us. I mean, when we used to talk time, maybe 5 years back, 7 years back, In the industry, we always used to talk about, you know, our commitment to the customer of delivery and will help the customer get what he wants on time. And that on time was being defined with planning systems of the organization. Now, what has happened is that underlying paradigm of time has dramatically undergone a change. You take any company today. Take an example of a company like Amazon. Sitting through this session, you feel like ordering something and you order it through the Amazon app. It pops up at 6 o'clock tomorrow, everything in your door, which means time as a parameter for competitive advantage has dramatically undergone a change simply because some enterprises in the world are able to deliver it much faster than someone else, and they're grabbing the market share. Similarly, when it comes to cost, there's a fundamental shift from landed cost calculation to total value costing, or someone calls it as total cost of ownership. So these are competitive levers which A, have to be understood, and two, have to be appreciated for how they have been changed in the past few years so that you are adaptable to them going forward. Else I still continue saying that I have an on-time, I'll give you a live example of a very old Indian company with whom I work. It's a $1 billion group in India. They commit six weeks of time to their customers for delivery. And I said, you're going to lose market share. They have 32% market share in the business that they are in. And within no time, an Ahmedabad-based supplier builds his own supply chain and his delivery in flat 7 days. Now, which customer would like to wait for 6 weeks of delivery if someone is going to give him it in 1 week? That's how I think the competitive levers are dramatically undergoing the change. The hypothesis on the basis of which they were built are getting altered a lot.
How does one appraise the financial impact of supply chain?
That's a very important question, to be honest. And because technology is being deployed to improve efficiency of the supply chain, this question actually has to be understood from that perspective. What are the 5 or 6 key measures that anyone can use? One, naturally, is return on invested capital. Second is your profitability ratios. The inventory turnover ratio, which has been a very important criteria for financial impact of the supply chain. In my opinion, many companies today, and particularly the ones which are stressed due to working capital cycle, they would love to actually understand the current ratio and the quick ratio for appreciation between an ability to be financially liquid versus inventory occupying a lot of space, and hence your current assets show higher, but you really don't have money to pay your suppliers, for example, as you know. So, and working capital cycle, I normally believe that these 5 or 6 ratios are good enough. Return on invested capital, profitability ratios, inventory turns, working cap number of days, current ratio, and in the 21st century going forward, quick ratio will be more important than just looking at what is called as the current ratio. Obviously, each one of them is a financial calculation to be done. If I have a 30-second time, I'll try and explain what I mean by return on invested capital from a technology perspective, because that's what I'm advising a lot of clients that I work with. Most companies today are implementing technology solutions where the benefits of the technology are being passed on to the end customer. So the retention of the benefits through productivity improvements don't stay with me, which means all the payback period calculations, all the return on invested capital calculations remain within the finance domain. And after some years, maybe a 3-year period of time, companies go back and say, oh God, I invested so much on this technology. Maybe I automated my shop floor. What happened is you automated the shop floor, you improved on the productivity of the shop floor, you could not retain the pricing. So from industry to industry, one has to make that as a very conscious decision. If it was a company like Coca-Cola, they can easily pass on the price to the customer. So all the benefits of technology implementation stay within the company called Coca-Cola. But if you're an automobile manufacturer, the productivity improvement as a result of technology implementation actually gets passed on to the customer because of the pricing competition in the marketplace. So I think return on invested capital will have to have a different perspective of being evaluated.
What are the opportunities for an entrepreneur in the domain of supply chain if he wants to think of starting as a new venture?
in India, we have got a large variety, to be honest. At least, I mean, the domain in which I work with clients, I mean, I'm lucky that I work with almost 80 or 90 different clients. But the new opportunities that I see are predominantly technology-driven opportunities for new startups. I'm advising a Bangalore-based startup, which is 4 years old now, and from a zero base to now a 50-employee company. What I see is there's a technology startup demand within the supply chain. And you don't need to really provide services like ERP, or you don't need to create a SAP APO as a product. But there are app-based solutions which the industry is looking forward to. So if you're a technology-oriented person, you may want to start up into a tech field within supply chain as a domain. All the way up to, I mean, I can explain you the entire horizon, but just to give you a flavor, on one side, I have these kind of startups. And on the other side, if you have a brick and mortar kind of a model that you want to develop, India's warehousing demand is going to dramatically increase. And there's no doubt about it. So, you can have a bricks and mortars business model where, you get into warehousing as a business, leasing of warehousing. In between these two extremes, there are multiple options. I mean, there are transportation service. I actually have a mentee of mine who has simply started a business where he gets the outsourced work from an OEM who has outsourced the entire procurement department to him. So all the follow-ups, all the coordination, getting the inventory to the doorstep of the manufacturer, which till yesterday was being done by the procurement professionals within the company, is completely outsourced to this guy. So, there are service opportunities, there are product opportunities. It depends on what you like, actually, or what core competencies do you carry with yourself.
Thank you, sir. And yeah. special thanks to our Tai Coimbatore's annual sponsor, Ambisoft Technologies. And here on, call upon Mr. Bhavin Bhagat to take over from here. Thank you.
Thank you, Devika. Now, I would like to ask a few questions to Mr. S. Ramakrishna. First of all, very warm welcome to you on behalf of all three Tai chapters. As an expert in the logistic and supply chain sector, could I please request you to please explain what is this crunch about container and air cargo these days? And second part of my question is, what can be done by exporter and importer to reduce the effect of this crunch? Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much. Well, this entire container crunch, whether it's a container as well as air crunch, came during the COVID period, that. And also added to that, because of the geopolitical situation between India and China, was also one of the major factor because of which the container movement into India became a little difficult. The origin of COVID, I don't want to get into it, but the entire world have news about the origin, and therefore the goods of China were not allowed into India majorly for 6-7 months, and the goods which came into India were also released after a lot of examination and scanning, etc. was prime reason. Number two, also because of the COVID and the restriction and the lockdown, the actual operation of the container movement. See, container is like a domestic road transport. Unless until that transport, the vehicle goes in circle quickly, the vehicle is not going to do a better utilization factor. So similarly, container cannot be stacked and parked at one place. Container has to be on the move all the time. So because of these two main reasons, the accumulation of container at various locations were there, and there was not free movement. The second aspect of it is that a lot of shipping lines have also stopped calling into India specifically because of the surge of containers and also congestion in the major ports. That is also one of the main reasons why it has not really. But I think now the situation has improved to a great extent. But still, there is congestion. There is scarcity of containers for specific location. There's also that the lot of players in the entire logistic game of international players have actually concentrating the business from end-to-end logistic, which means that, you know, if the business goes to them, they get the container. If the business does not go to them, there is a little amount of scarcity which is shown onto the market. A similar thing has happened in the air, because you see air, more belly cargo is taken for all predominant cargoes, which is small size cargoes. So when the airline started little movement or no movement from various countries into India and into India into outside, the obviously the crunch came onto the airline as well. And of course, there were also the larger players, the freighters were operated upon, but the cost of the air freight went so much high that, you know, the availability of air cargo also became scarce. So these are the basically two reasons why there was a problem. And in between, say, 4 months or 5 months after the first wave, things started moving quite smoothly. Now, again, we are in the second wave. There is same kind of a problem we anticipate. But credit to all the Indian airlines, especially Air India and other private operators, they actually did a wonderful job in the first wave. And they had used, including the courier companies, they had taken a sorties and brought in a lot of relief material into India, to their credit. This is how it is problem about the air and sea.
Is there anything, is there anything any importer or exporter can do in the current times to mitigate these challenges?
I would go to what Pinak said about it, is that in the entire supply chain management, we have to be really time bound supply chain management. If we have to do, then, you know, organizing our supply is most important. We are all the organized sector is fine, but again, when we really make the export, especially on the export front, we have a commitment and we start working backwards, how we should meet the end. Whereas it should be the other way around. We should have the material and we say, okay, we are committing on so-and-so date, and we should be able to deliver the cargo 5 days or 10 days before. So that is the way it is. As far as the import is concerned, import is India bounced back to various levels of just in concept, like the Japanese concept, which is the importers have no ability to now carry the inventory carrying capacity. So they all have been regularly getting the cargo in a phased manner, which gets cleared and, you know, utilized for the production. Now, because of the pandemic situation, it has really gone worse. So therefore, it is again getting into a level where they will have more inventory into their warehouses or from a public warehouses, so that, you know, they can keep the production on. But it is all said and done, then, you know, there has to be a very scientific method of projecting their demand and supply. Both, I think, both Andy and Pinak both talked about the technology. Here, the technology is the most important thing for accomplishing this job.
Sure. And one more question. You know, you mentioned about you know, the
30 minutes time and customs are clearing the cargo coming in. Apart from that, is there any one thing you would say that government body should do to make it easier for importers and exporters in current times?
Well, in one sentence, if I need to say that when we started our business in 80s and 90s, there used to be probably 16 signatures for an export cargo and 20 signatures for the import cargo. Today, there are no signatures at all. Everything is electronic. That's a big, big shift. But what is more important today is earlier, almost there was a trust level which has been given to the various importers, Exim Trade, and also to the custom brokers. They have created a lot of authorized economic operator, which is the AEO concept, where there are a lot of trust is given onto the entire Exim Trade. They are saying whatever they are importing, whatever they are declaring is correct. And also again on the technology front, the 360 degree of accounting of various cargo, right from the raw material stage to the finished stage to executing on the Exim level, it can be mapped very easily, so that, you know, and also the system actually generates the risk management of each individual of the import export code holders, how well they are doing and how more facilitation can be done. I think that is a very great thing which has been done by the systems.
I think in essence of time, I do have one or two more questions, but in essence of time, I'll pass it on to others. But in case if we have time left, I'll put those in the chat. Thank you, Mr. Ramakrishnan.
Thank you so much.
I'll pass it on to the next member.
Thanks, Bhavan. Good evening, all. In continuation to what you spoke in the introduction, Andy, I would like to ask you that with disruption comes opportunity. So what are the positive outcomes from the pandemic and the challenges of transformation in the United States market?
Thank you for that question. We have obviously through this pandemic, a lot of the supply chain models were fractured. And we have seen clients across from the states and abroad have all been forced to adapt new models from manufacturing to distribution. We have noticed that, as I mentioned in the beginning, a lot of their forecasting accuracy was not there. Resulted in increased costs. And so a lot of what has happened is in the positive is the pandemic has caused the embrace of technology that may have not been seen for 5 to 10 years out. And so this is a collaborative way of, as I said in the beginning, of different departments that used to be in silos coming together to really understand a true shift in priorities and what was really necessary to meet the demand that was there. Again, there's a balance there from understanding the challenges, but also understanding how we can really focus on the employees to bring them together and understand how we can all get through this as a team. And I use that word team very seriously because I think in a lot of the clients that we've worked with, we've noticed the shift of them calling their employees employees. We've noticed that they're all considered team members and really understanding the struggles from day to day. And I think one of the big things in identifying that we've been able to do as a team through functional and technical consultants going in and working with these clients to do a discovery and understanding their true needs. And through that, being able to lay out a plan of taking the best solutions possible and applying them to their workflows. And within that process, my team of seasoned consultants are able to go in and identify gaps in their workflow and within the organization. And again, I use this word collaborative because it doesn't take a team to understand looking at the gaps and understanding what can be done to fill these gaps through special reports, communication technology being applied, and working together to do this. And I think one of the key things that's come out of this is the interaction of people working together to understand how they can come together to solve these problems. But I do think the biggest positive is the adaptation of new technology being applied to employees and allowing them to work together to succeed. I think that's the best thing that has come out of this thus far.
Okay. So with some case study example, if you could share the cross-functional engagement within the organization and lessons learned that added value or may add value to the companies.
Yeah, very much. Thank you for that. Yes, the efficiency in planning. So it goes back to what I was saying about communication. In understanding that changes that where people would be meeting on a monthly basis to understand the struggles that they were having are now being done sometimes week to week or day to day, and listening to their clients also and responding to their needs in a faster manner, and playing out these scenarios, these what if scenarios, and understanding if this happens, then what do we do to react appropriately? What's also been effective is being able to improve the way they're forecasting accurately, because there was never a case in point in the past where businesses were shut down for a month or longer, and being able to apply that to the new forecast. So we've seen that the resilience of clients to really embrace their employees and bring them to work by applying and investing in their employees, not only through technology, but also in training and making sure that this new technology can be embraced. And what we've seen in the cross-functional is in the leadership support, bringing in sales, IT, the finance folks, all together to work in as one team, one unit. And so we're working with clients today that set up these different pods on a daily basis and have folks overseeing and extracting that information and then working together to kind of build out the new normal of how this supply chain will work. But the plus of that is just a more resilient, less gaps in their supply chain, which ultimately will be better for everyone in the long run.
Okay. Yeah, that's come to the point of next question we had on resiliences. Being a coach myself, we always talk about if you always do what you always did, you will always get what you always got. So you have to be resilient. And for business to be resilient, anything that you would like to suggest upon opening up to new ideas and how to manage those expectations from new processes you implement?
Yes, I think this is actually key. You have to break these down and apply to your supply chain appropriately. But I think inclusiveness is kind of key. As I stated before, leadership is able to now listen to their employees and also listen to their clients and draw from their expertise, and to have this being done in a collaborative way where they're listening to what's really necessary to be applying there, where, as I said, a lot of clients were applying older technologies that really were just outdated and not really applicable to today's times. And so they're able to apply new tools that are enabling their workforce and empowering them to really be more efficient in multiple ways. And it's also supporting the team and supporting that creativity and communication. I think all of these are ways for businesses to become more resilient and relying on their team members to kind of step forth and having a voice. So I think that's one of the key takeaways.
Okay. Over to you, Piali. You're mute.
Thank you so much for the questions. It was absolutely fantastic and very insightful listening to all our three panelists. We had requested our members to register, we had also requested them to provide us with the questions that they would like us to include in the discussions. So most of the questions that we had received from our delegates were part of the questions that we went through. However, we can have an open house now. And if there are any questions from any of you, we can, we have almost 5-7 minutes and we can take that.
If we have time, can I ask a
question? Yes, Bhavin, please.
Okay. So in today's Economic Times, there was this news report where they were saying that cargo flights, there is so much disruption because Chinese logistic and manufacturing companies and the price increase which have happened in recent days, especially because most return flights going back to China are empty because the manufacturers are not able to use that facility going back. So the whole logistic of the costing for a cargo flight is kind of disturbed. So I was wondering that in past as well, things like this would have happened. So what kind of impact it will bring in the short to midterm for air cargo?
There's a question for me.
Anyone.
Okay. Now, yeah, but, this is typically what used to happen earlier also was that it was not necessary a flight coming in from one origin to a destination and goes back to the same destination. There used to be a hub and spoke model where the cargo used to come to a destination where it used to pick up all other cargo and go to that hub. From there, it is to be redistributed. Similarly, there is some cargo available in that area for the destination as well. So that used to be the business model. Now, unfortunately, because of the various restrictions all over the world, this hub and spoke model actually is not really working very well. That is also the reason why the cost is skyrocketing.
Okay, so it will remain like that for a period of time, right?
Sometime, yes.
I just wanted to check, this was my observation. Recently, I was getting my place renovated. And from Gujarat to Cochin, instead of using the roadways, people are opting for waterways because the fuel pricing are so dynamic. Is it a way forward? Looks like more and more people are going towards waterways.
That was the first thing I started with, that inland waterways with the water available in the Indian region are so huge and enormous. The only thing is that the time taken in the inland waterways is surely more than the normal road transportation. But there are multimodal operations which is going to happen. It is not only going to be a roadway, so the inland waterways only. It has to be a road, water, as well as rail. Any kind of mode is going to happen, and you will really see in another, say, 3 to 4 years or 5 years max, the dynamism of the entire logistic business, especially domestic business, is going to change to a great extent.
There is one question I would like to take from the audience that we've received. Will this pandemic lead to Indian companies automating the labor-intensive warehouse operations like truck loading by standardizing their processes?
I don't know whether Pinak would like to answer. Otherwise, I would love to answer this.
I will love to answer, but you can go ahead.
No, please go ahead. Please go ahead.
Oh, we'll compliment each other.
Okay.
So maybe you go first, I go second.
Okay. Thank you so much. See, today, if you really see the entire operation today is on the, from a barcoding, it is moving to QR coding. From a QR coding, it is also the racks and places where the goods are going. It is going there on a QR coding. And it is also in probably by year end, there is going to be a drone movement also. So it is going to be so automated. The labor, of course, there will labor will be involved, but you know that skill of the labor is going to be so improved, then everything is going to be a real game changer.
I'll compliment what you said so that we don't have too much of an overlap. If you really look at the warehouse operations, and then you could actually distinguish three clear operations: incoming within the warehouse and then outgoing. Now, industry to industry, the application of technology will change. Pick, pack, and keeping it on the racks, it is already automated to a very large extent. I mean, people have already deployed ASRS, people have already got their systems in place. Each industry has a different need. So if you take transportation, so let's say companies like Mahindra Logistics or Gati or ECI Express, they handle such a large amount of work, but the volumes, the weight of the volume is lesser as compared to someone who is in L&T or who is in Siemens, who handles something in OEMs. So the level of automation within the warehouse is predominantly a function of that industry. I'll also like to highlight that when we try to automate a warehouse, and unfortunately as a consultant, I face this as a very major challenge. We have tremendous ground level issues of unionization. And Ramkrishna may actually be more vocal about it than me, because I still happen to be a consultant who can still say that, look, you know, you'll have to sort out the issues and get it done. But trust me, on the ground, we have two major challenges in automation. One is the unionization issue, and two, from state to state, we have got certain things which are, I may not be able to say that on a live session, but there are certain things which unfortunately drive the, you've got a cartel of transportation. So automation, while it looks like a very good term, what I intend to do with my clients is automate the operations within the warehouse. That's the first challenge. And let's try to do that and do a good job. Physical stock versus system stocks mismatch. Let's try to improve that. Let's improve the pick efficiency. Let's try to improve the sorting. These are simple but very powerful outcomes through technology. Loading, unloading, let's not get into it right now, because we as an organization don't want to get on the wrong side of the politics.
Sir, if it is okay, can I take one last question? In interest of time, it's 6:30. Just yeah, quickly from you.
I'm
last
good.
One. Great, thanks. So this question is that mergers and acquisitions in logistics sector, will that become the way forward or way to go for some of the logistics or the transportation companies to build a full 360 degree offerings to the customers? Open to all of you.
Same sequence?
Please.
Yeah, then you become first, I become second. Same sequence.
You go ahead. I'll supplement.
Okay, let me give it a try first, and then you can. M&A is a good term to use in logistics, but unfortunately, 80% of Indian logistics, not 80 now, 70% of Indian logistics is unorganized. They are pure play transportation. So instead of using a large jargon like M&A, I would probably believe that we'll create an ecosystem which a company like Mahindra Logistics has created. They have a fleet of 5,000 vehicles, but they don't own anything. You know, the ecosystem of logistics as an industry may actually evolve more as an partnership-based collaborative model, where it's like the Uberized model of life. So I have a core competence in technology. So, you know, I give you the technology for transportation. I have a core competence in warehousing. So I become a 3PL guy who handles your warehousing plus inventory. Then I say, okay, I want to be a lead logistics provider. So there's a concept which is getting practice in the industry now called LLP. Now the lead logistics provider is actually a service provider who does not actually own any of the vehicles. So, you know, I have got a company called Transport Corporation of India, formed in 1958, has a 60-year-old history of existence. Let them handle the fleet. No, why should I get into it? But I don't want to take over that company. Yeah, a Blue Dart and DHL kind of a merger happens once in a lifetime. But in Indian setups, I would believe that it's better to have a evolution of the ecosystem to an Uberized kind of a model rather than M&A as a route.
Okay. Basically, this sector, logistics sector, is a family-owned business, and nobody wants to just leave that out of the blood. Yeah. So that's a big thing. But having said that, today the youngsters who are coming into this with highly technical knowledge on this, they do. Hub and spoke model, what you talked about, that hiring of the vehicle and hiring of the warehouses and doing all these things. I think merger per se might not happen, but collaboration, yes, it is happening, and it is going to happen in a very large way.
Great. So, anyone? So
PLE, I have a question. PLE, I have a question. Actually, someone has sent on my personal chat.
Yes.
So the question is for Andy. Disruptions at international markets in supply chain sector. Any case study that is helping businesses back to track? Andy, we would like to know your thought and your 2 cents on this.
Yes, yes. I think what you're finding is that with the companies here that are working through these supply chains, both nationally and internationally, you're seeing a sharing of knowledge where it used to be held as intellectual property. You're seeing companies wanting to figure out collectively how they can work together. So I see that a lot of that being applied to be able to improve the resilience of supply chains across the board, where, again, I go back to where it used to be isolated and companies weren't willing to share this intellectual property. I'm seeing that they're being stronger together than independent. So I think you'll find that to be increased through the years. And it's something that I've been excited to see, where a lot of our clients right now are also sharing and working in these forums together to kind of hash out these same issues that we brought up today during this discussion. So I think some of the positives that have come out of this pandemic is a collective, just like we are all together today. You're seeing leadership across other tier one clients, and that flows down to other clients, where other tiers, where they're taking lessons learned and sharing those and being able to be stronger together. So I think that's something we can all take away as a positive.
Thanks, Andy. And there was the things which we are telling about the resilient business resilient. So how to manage those expectations? If you can share your 2 cents in 60 seconds, that will really help everyone.
Yeah, I think managing the expectations is key, because you have to be able to figure out how you take time to really, from the top level down, being able to trust the new process that's being put in place, really backing your team members and giving them positive reinforcement, because change is difficult. We all know that. So I think really you have to highlight the successes that your team is having day to day, and really be behind them from a leadership perspective, to be able to be working hands-on. You'll see a lot of leadership now rolling up their sleeves and getting into the trenches for their team to really make sure they're empowering everyone to work together. And I think collectively, that's how they'll succeed.
Thanks, Andy. Thank you so much. So over to you, Piali.
Bhavin, I want to check with you. You had a question, I think. Do you still have it? Can't hear you, Bhavin. No, can't hear you.
Question to Andy?
Yes.
Okay. Hi, Andy. I want to know your clients from US. What do they think about entering into India or via some collaboration, some kind of partnership, some kind of merger acquisition? In 21, do you see that kind of inquiry coming in your way, or?
Well, we see it all the time here, to be honest with you. We see mergers taking place not only domestically, but internationally. And I think you'll see more, even in the space that I work at Adelaplex, where we used to work in the Americas, now we spread out in EMEA. We have, five different centers throughout India. And we see a lot of cross collaboration, not only from personnel to personnel, but as I was saying earlier, you see companies coming together and merging together. Although, as mentioned by the other participants that are speaking today, that can be difficult at times, but what you're able to do is come together and pick the best of each part and bring those technologies and like-minded ways to be able to come in and be innovative together. So I do see it more and more taking place. And I think you'll see the world becoming smaller and smaller, where we're willing to work in a collaborative way together.
Sure. And the last one, just add on to that question. There are lots of technology companies working in the logistics sector, especially in B2B side, domestically in India. Do you get inquiries not just for traditionally well-settled, matured logistic company, but also your clients looking at some very high-end, technologically sound startups in India?
from my perspective, yes. There are no borders anymore when it comes to corporations wanting to embrace innovative technology. To me, those have all disappeared. So, I don't think that there are any limitations. I think it actually, for entrepreneurs out there, it's a great opportunity because if you bring something to light that improves supply chain or any part of the workflow within any organization, it'll be embraced no matter where you stand.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Piali, for the time to ask questions.
Thanks, Bhavin. If we do not have any other questions, then possibly we can now close. In the interest of time, we have almost taken 10 additional minutes. So I would like to take the opportunity session today. It was absolutely interesting. A lot of insights and a lot of new things that I guess we all have been able to learn. Special thanks to our speakers for the evening, Mr. S. Ramakrishna, Mr. Andy Tuggle, and Mr. Pinak Kulkarni. Thank you to our moderators, Devika Ramesh, Bhavin Bhagat, and Rashmi Bansal. Absolutely great questions, which could help us all answer everything that we received from all our delegates and our participants. Thank you to the presidents of all the three chapters for being here with us today and absolutely having, encouraged us every month to have this impact speaker series, which brings in a new topic and a lot of interesting, awareness and understanding for everyone who's joining from all over the country. So thank you once again. And we look forward to having you again in the next month for our next session. Thank you and have a good evening.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Pinak. Thanks, Ramakrishna. And thanks, Andy. And of course, all EDs, you guys are doing a fantastic work. I'm sure lots of takeaways today as usual, and look forward to a new session soon next month. Yeah. Thanks very much once again. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.